Thus is memory of Jared Orchen. And in this week's parshas, we read about Abraham. It's three parshas all about Abraham. Lech Lecha, Vayera, Chaye Soro, three parshas about Abraham. And we see something very interesting. We see Abraham in the beginning, what it's not written in the parsha, in the Torah, in the text. There is a whole part of the life of Abraham that's written in the Midrash. Abraham, until the age of 75, is not mentioned in the Torah. The first time Abraham is mentioned as something is by the age of 75. Before that, it's only written that Abraham was born. Terach had three sons, Nahor, Abraham, Haran, and Nahor. And it's written later that he left Ur Kasdim with Abraham and Nahor. Oren's name is not mentioned. Comes the Midrash and fills us in on the whole story. Something that every Jewish child in preschool knows. Abraham was a young man. In the age of 3 years old, he started to think about God. Started to ask himself, where is God? What is God? And because he started his journey when he was 3 years old, that's why a Jewish boy, we cut his ear and we give him payas by the age of 3 years old. It's called the Obsheranish. Then you give him a special ear, the first ear cut, when he's 3 years old. It's symbolizing that Abraham's journey for Judaism started by the age of 3. And Abraham started to ask himself, what's going on here? And little by little he discovered that this, he started maybe the sun. Maimonides writes it in detail. And then he saw the sun is coming down. Maybe the moon. So the moon is also disappearing. It's not the moon. It's not. And by process of elimination, he came to the conclusion it must be something bigger than that. And he finally took him until the age of 40, and then the age of 48, that he came to the monotheistic religion. That must be a God that is not tangible, and you don't see, and you don't hear, a force that is bigger than all of this. And we came to the conclusion, he couldn't take it that everybody else is worshipping idols. He was born to a father who was an idol worshipper. Didn't know anything about, he never heard about God ever. And his father had a whole manufacturing business of idols. And once his father had to go out of town for a business trip, and he asked his son to be in the store until he comes back. People used to come into the store and ask Abraham, they want to buy an idol. And Abraham tell him, are you crazy? Are you going to pay money for this thing? You really think this is God? He cannot even move. Cannot. You know, it was not doing good for the business. He convinces people that it's not a good idea. And then before his father came back home, he took an axe and he broke all the idols beside the biggest one. And he put the axe in the end of the biggest idol. And he left. His father comes home, goes into the shop, and he sees the churban. He couldn't believe it. He calls Abraham, what's going on? What is happening here? Abraham points on the big idol and says, he did it. The guy looks at him and says, are you crazy? His father looks at him. He cannot, what he did it? He said, I cannot move. Then why you believe in him? His father didn't appreciate this lesson. And his father is a loyal communist. Reported them to his boss, Nimrod. Nimrod was then the king. Nimrod was a grandson of Ham, the son of Noah. Ham, the son who was cursed, was Ham, Canaan. The son of Ham was Canaan, and the son of Canaan was Nimrod. Nimrod was not a good guy. Nimrod was a true dictator. Nimrod told them, called Abraham for a meeting, told him, you believe it? He said, no. He says, okay, that I will deal with you with my God. The God of Nimrod was the God of fire. He said, we'll throw you into the fire, and then we'll see if your God can save you. And Abraham had a brother, Haran. And they asked Haran, Haran, on which side are you? Haran said, I will see. If Abraham comes out alive, I'm an Israeli. You know, on the side of the winners after the election, I'll say I voted for the guy who won the election. If they say, and if it doesn't come out alive, I believe in the idols. Abraham said he was ready to be told, if you don't believe in our God, we'll throw you into the furnace. He said, you can do whatever you want. I believe in my God. Abraham was ready to give his life for his belief. He was thrown into the furnace. And Hashem made a huge miracle. Abraham came out alive. Then they asked Haran, "Nu, which side are you?" He said, "I'm with the side of Abraham." They throw him into the furnace, and he's still there. First of all, a side note, why didn't happen the miracle to Haran, like to Abraham? Abraham was ready to die for God. He didn't count on miracles. That God made him a miracle. But if you count on a miracle, that you make sure that a miracle will not happen. If you count that God is coming to save you, don't go there. The first condition for a miracle is that you are ready to go all the way. If you're not ready to go all the way, don't play the game. If you are ready to go all the way, maybe God will save you. That's up to God. If God says that you are so dedicated that you are ready to die for Him, maybe He'll save you. But if you are not ready to do it, that's for sure you taking away the condition that a miracle should take place. When Terach saw that he lost his son Oron, he decided maybe it's not such a good place. Ur-Kasdim, Ur-Kaldean it's called. It was in Iraq. He took his family with him. He took Abraham and Sarah, and Lot, the son of Oron, who just died. And they left from Ur-Kasdim to Haran, on the way to Canaan. The goal was to get to Canaan. But you know, on the way they got stuck in Haran, and they stayed there. That's all written in the Medrash. The first time the mentioned name of Abraham is mentioned from God in the Torah, it's written, God told Abraham, Lech Lecha, go for your way. Go where? Go to Israel. Go to the land of Canaan. And Abraham, how old was Abraham at that time? 75 years old. And it's written, Abraham took with him his wife Sarah and his nephew Lot and all the people that he converted in Haran, and they came to the land of Canaan. And then it's written the whole story about Abraham, what he did in the land of Canaan. And there is a rabbi who lived 200 years ago in Hungary. His name was Rabbi Moshe Sofer. He was called the Chatam Sofer. Very famous rabbi, very famous rabbi. Everybody knows him in the religious world. And he asked a question. He says, why Abraham, it's written in Ur-Kasdim, in Iraq, he was fighting with the, breaking the idols, and he was making arguments, dialogues with the non-Jews, convincing them that he's right, and he was in, and he won the arguments with them. And you don't see it when he came to Israel. Canaan, the land of Canaan at that time, was not like a whole land of Israel, we go to the Kotel and then we go to Mezada. It was full of idols. Just like in Iraq. And we don't read in the Bible anywhere that Abraham was fighting the idols. And we don't read anything that he was making arguments and dialogues and being thrown into furnace. Nothing! Going around, actually trying to be nice to people. In this parsha of this week in Chayei Sarah, when we read about that he had to bury his wife Sarah, he had to buy a grave, a cave to bury her. He actually goes to the people of Chayei, he bows down to them, he pays them money. A nice guy. No fighting, no screaming, no breaking. What changed? Not only this, before this, in the last week's parsha, we read about a guy with the name Avimelech, right? Avimelech was a king in Israel. Abraham doesn't fight with him. He actually makes with him a treaty, makes a covenant with him. I will not attack your people, you will not attack my people. He's having... Abraham, a nice guy. What changed? What happened? The answer is simple. Abraham, in Iraq, was arguing with people, proving them that they are wrong. He proved them. And he was able to prove them, and he was right. He broke idols. He taught the furnace. He came out from the furnace. Such a huge miracle. And when he left Ur Kasdim, when he left Iraq, not one person left together with him. Who left with him? Terach, his wife, and his nephew. He didn't convert a minyan, a half a minyan, a few schleppers who should come with him. Nothing. Not one person.
Sounds like
a... Later, when he came from Haran to Israel, at Sritni had a whole following already. Men, women, the text said the nefesh, the people that he made in Haran, and Rashi explains, the Talmud explains, Abraham converted men, Sarah converted women, he had a whole following. Abraham realized that with arguments and fights and proving and even miracles, you're not convincing one person. The way to get to the heart of people is in a nice way. That when he came to Haran, he stopped arguing, he stopped fighting, and when he went to Israel, he made it into a profession. He set up tents, and he offered people food, and invited people, and they asked them after the meal, thank you, they want to thank him. Who should we have to thank? You know, in the Kiddush Bayas, every Shabbos there is another sponsor. They ask, people ask me, who is the sponsor? Who is the person? Not every time you know the person is, and they come over and thank him. And he says, you don't have to thank me, you have to thank God. God, we never heard about God. Start to tell them about God. Oh, that's an interesting thought. That if they convinced themselves and they believed in God, fine. If not, oh, they said, no, we don't want to thank God, we don't believe in it. Okay, then pay. Oh, when you tell people pay, they start to reconsider it. Maybe it's about it to believe in God. And in this way, little by little, you know, when you can talk to a person after he ate a meal, when you make a good business deal, after lunch, after supper, after breakfast. In America, you don't do any businesses without food. Then you can talk to them. Finally, Abraham became a Chabadnik. He got it. It's not about proving. Keep proving until tomorrow. Nobody cares. That's why the Rebbe never liked the dialogues between religions. He said, because nobody is there to be convinced. Everybody wants to prove it that he's right. It's about a fight. If I have a dialogue with you, I'm not going to be convinced. I'm not even listening to. When you talk, I'm preparing to go to the next argument. Nobody's going to forget about dialogues. Forget about breaking idols. Forget about fighting with people. Talk to him. Bring him closer. There's a story. Once a guy was standing at the wall and screaming to God and praying and screaming. That somebody tips on his shoulder and says, you ever tried in a good way? What are you screaming? You're fighting that? Maybe try in a nice way. Talk to him. Nice, quiet. Tell him, God, you know, I have a problem. What are you screaming? Maybe he's... You tried in it? You already lost them before you start speaking. You're screaming, he's already not hearing. That's the way the Rebbe taught us how to bring it to preach in Judaism. That's why Chabad is not big on proving somebody that the Torah is true. Proving there is a God. You're proving anybody anything. You're not convincing anything to anybody. The more you prove and the more he sees he's wrong, the more he's angry. If he comes to be out that a fool, he walks away, he's more angry. Put him on film, give him a little chant. Proving in argument. And the same thing is today. It's such a climate. Everybody wants to prove that the other person is wrong. Not one person was convinced yet. Not one, not a quarter of a person. And I'm guilty in the same thing. Who wants to be proved that he's wrong? You ever met a Jew who admitted that he was wrong? I never met him yet. Not one person in all my life. Never about anything, no matter what the issue is. A Jew is never wrong. I never met a Jew who's wrong.
Except that there was.
Even he's right, he says he's wrong. Then the idea is, the lesson is from Abraham is, and that's why the stories of Ur Kasdim in Iraq is not written in the Bible. Because this is not, the Bible writes us only Torah, the word Torah comes from the word Ora'ah. Ora'ah means directions. The Torah is a way to teach us how to live life. The way of Ur Kasdim is not the way to live life. That was never made it to the Bible. There's a big question. Until the age of 75, such good stories with the furnace and approving and breaking the ice, not of it is written in the Bible. Why not? Because it doesn't make a difference. Because this is, was not, that was the way that Abraham tried one way and it didn't work. Now we know the right way. We should learn from his mistakes. Then we don't even write it. We write the right way. Abraham went out to Israel and he was nice to people and he was kind to them and he brought them back to believe in God. And that's how the whole world today accepted the monotheistic belief. The whole main three religions. Why? Because Abraham gave food. That's it. He was nice. He didn't break idols. He didn't fight with anybody. And that's the lesson to us.